Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Maimuna Akhtar from School of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Jamia Hamdard. Today we are going to discuss about a module, Factors Influencing Chemiluminescence Emission, under paper Atomic Spectroscopy. After completing this module, you should be able to understand the process of losing energy from the excited state luminescent reaction systems, the role of chemiluminescent reagents and its concentration. In addition to the chemical reagents that are responsible for these reactions and its concentration, various other factors that affect the chemiluminescence process like catalyst, their concentration, structural and environmental considerations, effect of solvent, pH and ionic strength of the solvent, and other enhancers on the chemiluminescent systems. We'll also discuss brief about the chemiluminescent basis analysis. So what is chemiluminescence? So we all know, we have discussed in our previous module that chemiluminescence is an emission of light, that is luminescence, due to reaction of chemicals. Chemiluminescent reactions generally yield a product in an electronically excited state producing visible light. That is, for example, if you have two chemicals, chemical A and chemical B, it reacts, it produces a product with light. As a general rule, only exothermic reactions can generate the required energies for chemiluminescence. Therefore, most chemiluminescent reactions use potential oxidants like oxygen, hydrogen peroxide, etc. The energy must be generated in a single reaction step, and the molecule receiving this energy must have limited number of accessible vibrational energy states, which would otherwise act as energy sink. That means if it has more than one or number of vibrational energy levels, it will lose small packet of energy rather than giving it in the form of light. If the excited state is emissive, it can chemiluminesce directly. However, it can also transfer the energy to another molecule which following excitation then emits the energy as light. The light capacity of the chemiluminescent system is related to the intensity and lifetime by the equation given, that is L is equal to the integration of intensity dt over V, where V is the volume of the reaction solution. It is clear from this equation that light capacity can be evaluated in terms of intensity and the transmission. Here we can see different processes that lead to losing energy from the excited state. Let's assume AB star is the excited or energy rich species. The system can come into the ground state in number of forms. First, it can be a light emissive process wherein it will come back to the ground state giving back the molecule and light. It can dissociate. The energy it has gained will result in the dissociation of the molecules. In such cases, no luminescence is observed. The energy may be used for chemical reaction with other species, and you will have some other products which may or may not luminesce. There can be intramolecular energy transfer. In case of fluorophores, indirect chemiluminescence can be seen if it is an energy-rich molecule and tends to lose energy in the form of light. Gaining of energy may lead to isomerization of the compound and loss of chemiluminescence, and it may also have another effect, can be physical quenching of the fluorescence. There are large number of factors that affect the chemiluminescent reactions, or we can say the process of chemiluminescence. The first and foremost, we know that chemiluminescence is a process which occurs due to reaction of two reagents or two chemicals. That means the chemicals, their concentration, their structure is very important for chemiluminescence, and they will decide what type, amount of the light luminescence that is produced. Other factors are environmental factors, for example, catalyst, other use of metal ions, the pH and ionic strength of the system, of the chemical reaction system, the hydrophobicity of the solvent and solution, and presence or absence of other transfer accepts. The nature of solvent, like hydrophobicity and composition of solution. For example, the luminol oxidized in dimethyl sulfoxide is 0.05 with blue-violet color, which comes around at 425 nanometers, to 0.01 in water with blue green, which comes around 480 to 502 nanometers. So you can see the change in the hydrophobicity of the solvent has made the wavelength shift from 425 to 480 with change in the color also. So we'll discuss the factors that affect the chemiluminescence one by one. First, let's see how chemical structure of the chemiluminescent precursors affect. An essential condition for any reaction to occur is the structure. In chemiluminescent reactions also, the precursor of the light-emitting species, it must participate in reaction that release a considerable amount of energy. If it does not participate, no reaction will be seen. For visible emission, that means if we want to see a visible emission from a chemiluminescent reaction, visible emission means seeing wavelength between 400 to 750 nanometers. 40 to 70 kilocalories per mole of energy is required for such reactions to happen. So in order to compensate the energy loss due to thermal relaxation in the ground state and lowest excited state of the fluorophore, the enthalpies of the reaction have to be slightly greater than these values. That means if you actually want to see a chemiluminescence from a reaction system, their energy in kilocalories per mole should be more than 40 to 70. The energy produced must be channeled into a reaction pathway so that the reactant corresponding to the transition state of the initial reaction and potentially emissive product in lowest excited singular state has the same energy and a comparable geometrical structure. If it does not meet these conditions, we cannot see a luminescent reaction. So this closeness of the identity of the species ensures that most of the energy of activation is channeled into free energy of activation rather than being wasted as entropy or activation. There will also be other pathways like dark reaction, which may lead to directly to the ground state, electronic state, without the release of energy in the form of fluorescence. A competing dark reaction that leads directly to ground state products, different from that produces a fluorescence, may also happen. This only occurs when the lowest excited singular state of the fluorophore has the same geometrical configuration as ground electronic state of the reactant at lower energy than when the dark product in ground electronic state. So let's consider the sum of the enthalpies of activation of all dark reactions competing with the chemiluminescent pathways as delta H4 and assuming their enthalpy of activation as delta HI. The chemiluminescence will only occur when delta H4 is less than delta H4I. That means the sum of enthalpies of activation of all dark reactions should always be less than the enthalpy of the activation. Concentration of fluorescent compounds and their effect on chemiluminescent systems. We all know that for any reaction, we need reagent. And we also know that concentration of the reagent will have different effects. So concentration of fluorescent species do affect the light emission from chemiluminescent reactions. It has been observed that the emission increases linearly. That means concentration increase, emission increase, up to certain values of the reacting species, beyond which a decrease has been observed. The reason for this decrease may be concentration quenching or maybe loss of energy due to collision, because as concentration increases, collision will also increase. The influence of concentration on fluorescence was studied by changing the variable from 0.2 to 0.8 milligram per ml, while the other variables remained constant. The result shows that light intensity maxima increases by 30% on increasing the fluorescent concentration from 0.0 to 0.5 milligram per ml. High concentrations, however, results virtually constant or even slightly lower light intensity, which possibly is because the effect of concentration quenching. And experiments have showed that you have to have first optimization experiments carried out with different fluorescent systems to have a validated system to work on. Here we can see a graphical representation of the effect of concentration of luminol on chemiluminescent intensity. In the graph on x-axis, we can see the log concentration of the luminol against the area to noise ratio of the signals obtained from it. So you can see there is a gradual increase in the chemiluminescence with increase in the luminol concentration, but after reaching a peak, the luminescence does not increase. There may be number of reasons for this. One, it can be that with increase in concentration, the energy is lost due to collision. Second, there may be self-quenching of the compounds. This is another example of effect of concentration of oxidant, that is hydrogen peroxide, on the chemiluminescence. This graph is representation effect of peroxide concentration on fluorescent intensity, and it can be observed from this graph that after certain limit, the luminescence does not grow with increase in concentration. Again, it may be due to the same reason that there may be self-quenching of the system. Photophysical consideration. So immediately after the formation of potential chemiluminescent molecule in the lowest excited singular state, a series of events takes place which tend to pull down the excited state molecule to its ground state. At first, the rapid stepwise thermal deactivation, which is also known as vibrational relaxation, in the excited state of the molecule takes place. This means that small amount of energy is released as packets while coming from the highest vibrational level to the lowest possible vibrational level. In this thermal or vibrational relaxation, the excited molecule loses small packets of energy by inelastic collision with the solvent and thereby carrying the molecule to the lowest excited singular state. Here in this figure, you can see the energy diagram of a chemiluminescent system, which you have also seen in the fluorescence spectroscopy, because the phenomena is same except the source of generation of the light is different. In fluorescence, it is non-reactive, it is natural due to the photon absorption, whereas in case of chemiluminescence, it is due to the reaction of the chemicals. But basic process is same. And you can see the small arrows in black, they represent the vibrational relaxation, that means release of small packets of energy from the highest vibrational level to the possible nearby vibrational levels, and thereby releasing small packets until they are in the lowest singlet excited state vibrational level available. This process sometimes results in radiation less return of certain molecules to the ground electronic state through a process known as internal conversion. The excited state molecule returns to ground electronic state, and that can occur by more than one alternative method, the simplest being the direct emission of ultraviolet or visible radiations, wherein you see the fluorescence, which can be called as chemiluminescence, and whose frequency or wavelength is determined by the energy gap between the lowest excited singular state and the ground electronics state. In some molecules, the return from the lowest vibrational level of the lowest excited singular state to the lowest vibrational level of the ground state by internal conversion and vibrational relaxation is forbidden, so you can see fluorescence only in those cases. The photoemissive transition, that is the luminescence you see, from singlet excited state to ground state without the change in spin multiplicity occurs in 10 to power minus 10 to 10 to power minus 5 seconds after excitation. You can see this is such a short period that immediately as soon as it absorbs light, it radiates back that light within 10 to power minus 10 to 10 to power minus 5 seconds. And such a phenomena is known as fluorescence. Therefore, the chemiluminescence is also kind of fluorescence. This phenomena of fluorescence is competed by a number of processes for deactivation of the lowest excited singular state. And as a result, only small number of molecules in the lowest excited singular state exhibit fluorescence. That means not all molecules that absorb energy and go into the excited state return back by radiating back the energy in the form of light. There are only small number of molecules which come to lowest floor, or can say ground state, after releasing energy in form of light. This is given by a term called quantum yield and is represented by phi. This phi is a fraction that is related to the probabilities or rate constants of fluorescence, competitive processes, and in some exceptions, it approaches to 1, for example, in case of fluorescein. Some of the external factors which affect the chemiluminescent process involves the effect of catalyst. We already know that catalysts are those substances which accelerate the rate of reaction. So here they also do the same. So they also affect the chemiluminescent reactions. In chemiluminescent systems, the catalysts usually are transition metals, whereas in case of bioluminescent reactions, the catalysts usually are enzymes. Catalysts used in chemical reactions or chemiluminescent reactions do not have simply a positive effect. It's not that always the catalyst results in increase in the chemiluminescent reaction. The catalysts work by forming a transient complex with reagents whose delta enthalpy or change in enthalpy is lower than that of uncatalyzed reaction. The catalyst is usually a co-oxidant, that is, it assists in electron transfer. For example, cobalt-2 catalyzes the reaction of luminol and hydrogen peroxide. The reaction of luciferin and oxygen is catalyzed by the enzyme luciferase. But merely considering the presence or absence of catalysts for chemiluminescent reactions will be a mistake. The concentration of catalysts plays an important role in chemiluminescent reactions. For example, potassium salicylate, which has been used as a catalyst in many chemiluminescent reactions, it affects the intensity of the reaction or luminescence when used in different concentrations. It has been seen that when used in concentration of 0.2 mg per ml or less, the effect is minimum or negligible. But when the same is used in higher concentrations, there is dramatic increase in the maximum light intensity. But at the same time, considerable reduction in the efficient illuminating time has been observed, therefore prohibiting the use of potassium salicylate practically. Some catalysts like oxalic acid, which are effective in concentration of 1.2 mg per ml or higher, significantly inhibit the chemiluminescent reactions. So consequently, in order to control the emission within the specified intensity for various practical illuminating purposes, the addition of suitable amount of oxalic acid is recommended, or for that matter, any other catalyst that is being used, the concentration of the catalyst used for the particular reaction should be optimized first. Here you can see a representation of the effect of catalyst concentration on emission decay curve. Curve A is a blank where no catalyst has been added. 2 is a reaction where oxalic acid has been added in 1.2 mg per ml quantity, and 3rd is the oxalic acid has been added in 2.4 mg per ml. We can see the uncatalyzed reaction has high intensity but it decays fast, whereas the intensity in other two cases where catalyst has been added is comparatively low, but the time of the effect is long. So like we know, chemiluminescent reactions are reactions which are due to chemical substances. When we say chemical substance, that means structure. When we say a substance system, that means other solvent is also involved. So structure as well as other environmental factors affect the chemiluminescent species. So molecules that enter into chemiluminescent reactions are generally reduced species that can be easily oxidized, for example, compounds containing hydroxyl or amino groups or polycyclic aromatic ring systems. Hydroxyl groups and some aryl amido groups undergo deprotonation in strongly alkaline conditions, making them more susceptible to oxidation. Whereas electronic charge stabilizing groups, like electron withdrawing groups, you can say halogens, make oxidation more difficult in molecules to which they are attached, therefore adversely affecting the chemiluminescent reaction. Effect of solvent. Chemiluminescent reactions or experiments are carried out in solvents, and we all know different solvents have different viscosities. So therefore, the viscosity of the solvent will have some effect on the chemiluminescent reactions. Also, the densities of the vibrational state of the potential surface, representing the ground states of reactants and products, and the lowest excited singular state of the potential fluorophores are directly affected by the solvation. In this slide, we can see different solvents have been used and the effect of them on the emission decay curve can be seen. First curve is in dimethyl phthalate. Second is in dibutyl phthalate. Third has been used di-2-methylhexyl phthalate. D is 50% dibutyl phthalate and 50% di-2-methylhexyl phthalate. We can see in 2-dimethylhexyl phthalate, the fluorescence intensity is so suppressed and it is almost constant over a period of time. Whereas in case of dibutyl phthalate, the intensity is quite high and for longer duration. This is another example of effect of organic solvent concentrations on chemiluminescent intensities. The system, chemiluminescent system that has been selected for study is luminol, hydrogen peroxide, HRP and HIOP. In first case, you can see the effect of solvent. The fluorescence first gradually increases, then after certain concentration, it decreases rapidly. In second case, you can see a very erratic effect of organic solvent concentration or chemiluminescent intensity. For example, using DMF, you can see an up and down in fluorescence intensity. Using acetone, again, up to some concentration, very up and downs have been seen, and then slightly a plateau has been seen. In case of third, you can see the effect of DMF. In the third graph is the effect of the four solvents on luminol, hydrogen peroxide, HRP4, BOP system. And we can see with different solvents have different effect. So that indicates when you are working on a chemiluminescent system, you first have to optimize your system, then you can perform the analytical procedures. The solvent pH also has effect, and solvent ionic strength has also effect on chemiluminescent intensity. And this has been represented or explained by studying the chemiluminescent intensity of luminol and vitamin B12 or thiamine reaction. The maximum intensity has been observed at 10.5 pH, that means alkaline pH. The effect of pH varied with various catalysts. For example, when cobalt was used as catalyst, the maximum intensity was observed at pH 11.2 instead of 10.5. So again, mentioning the same thing that before performing any practical, optimize the conditions for your system. This is again another example of effect of pH and ionic concentration on the chemiluminescent kinetics of luminol, hydrogen peroxide and HRP enhancer system. You can see different pH have different time dependence on different fluorescence dependence. It's not that only the concentration of reactant, concentration of the oxidant, concentration of the catalyst affects the chemiluminescent system. It is the flow rate of these systems also that affect the process. That means in addition to the concentration, you have to look into the flow rate at which those agents are fed into the system. Because if the flow rate is very high, you may not be allowing sufficient time for reaction to occur. So that means the flow rate will be one of the crucial parameters in studying the chemiluminescent system. And again, an experiment revealing the effect of flow rate, which is explained in the graph in next slide, that the light intensity in study of the thiamine and luminol has revealed that the flow rate of 1.91 milliliter per minute is optimum for the experiment. Here we can see the chemiluminescent intensity versus flow rate graph, and you can see the flow rate affects the chemiluminescence intensity. This picture from PLOS One also shows you the effect of enhancers on the chemiluminescent intensity on the luminol, hydrogen peroxide, and HRP system. Different enhancers have been used, and we can see different effects with the concentration of the enhancer. 4-imidazole-1-ylphenol has the highest effect at 1 mole per liter of the solution. From the figure, we can see that phenol compounds with different substituent positions will have different enhancing effect. An enhancing para position substituent will have better luminescence effect compared to other positions. The imidazole group of the para position will have better luminescence enhancing effect compared to the halogenated group. Or a halogenated group may have better luminescent effect than methoxy group and phenyl group. So by now, you have developed a fairly good idea about what chemiluminescence is, that how chemiluminescence is produced by reacting different chemical species, obtaining a product of high energy which releases its excess energy in the form of luminescence, what factors affect, how different chemical species, catalyst, pH of the solution affect the chemiluminescence process. So we will come to brief explanation of the analysis that are based on chemiluminescence. The chemiluminescence reaction rate is function of the chemical concentration as other reactions are. That means the reaction of chemical luminescence is proportional to the chemical concentration of the reactants. So therefore, this technique of chemiluminescence, measuring chemiluminescence, has been used for quantitative analysis. Quantitative means you measure the quantity of particular thing. The usefulness of chemiluminescence system in analytical chemistry is based on some special characteristics. The first characteristic is the technique simultaneously comprises kinetic and luminescence features, because as the reaction proceeds, luminescence goes on. So it will take into consideration both kinetic aspect as well as the luminescence aspect. So it provides highly sensitive and wide dynamic range, excellent detection limits in the range of femtomoles even. So for example, in the gas phase detection, the limit is up to 10 picomoles. So if nitrous oxide with ozone is used, the limit of detection can be up to 0.1 picomoles. In the liquid phase, the limit of detection is up to 1 femtomole. That means you have the vast range, that means the small amount of substance can be detected. The 1 femtomole of the fluorophore can be detected. And if you use the peroxalate chemical system, you can even increase the sensitivity of the system. Chemiluminescence is 10 to power 5 times more sensitive than absorption spectroscopy. And it's more than 10 to power 3 times sensitive than fluorimetric analysis. That is, even the fluorimetry analysis is based on the emission, the chemiluminescence is better than the fluorimetric analysis. Less or absence of scattering or background as compared to the photoluminescence process is an advantage of chemiluminescence determination, because in chemiluminescent reactions, the light is not used. That means the source of energy is not used. The source of energy is the reaction between the two molecules. So therefore, all the interferences that generate by the use of light are automatically removed. Reduction of interferences due to non-selective excitation processes and simple instrumentation can have selectivity and linearity, which are dependent on conditions chosen. That means what type of reaction you choose, you will have a linearity and dependence. Any substance that can participate in chemiluminescence process can be analyzed. Virtually any substance can be done if it can take part in chemiluminescent reaction in any form. It can produce a chemiluminescent reaction or it can quench a chemiluminescent reaction. It can be determined by this technique. Indirect determination of substance by coupling reactions to generate a product with chemiluminescence can also be performed using this technique. depending on the nature of analyte and the chemical reaction, the increase or decrease of chemiluminescent intensity will be directly related to the analyte concentration. That means you can directly read the concentration of the amount of emission produced from the reaction. Chemical luminescent reactions can be coupled as a detection technique in chromatography, capillary electrophoresis, or immunoassays, which we'll discuss in another module where you will see the applications of the chemiluminescent reactions. It provides qualitative as well as quantitative information, or it can be used in large variety of species in gas-liquid phases. It, as an empirical rule, chemiluminescent behavior may be predicted in a compound or its derivatization product that has fluorescence property. So students, let's now summarize what we have learned in this module. We have learned, or you can say we have brushed about the basic concept of the chemiluminescence, what factors, internal and external factors, affect. Internal factors like the structure of the molecule, the state of the molecule, how it affects the chemiluminescent reaction. External factors like solvent, concentration of catalyst, pH of the solvent, how those factors affect the chemiluminescent systems, and how the chemiluminescent system can be used in quantitative and qualitative analysis of other substances. Thank you.